About a month ago now, I built a new editing PC because my old rig was starting to show its age, and I was also excited to take advantage of that new feature in Premiere Pro, which allows hardware-accelerated encoding using Intel graphics. Today we're going to talk about that setting and why I do not recommend using it. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What is happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and today's video is all about exporting video from Premiere Pro. So let's start off by setting the stage a little bit with my PC and putting out a couple quick disclaimers. So first up, this is not a brand bashing video. I'm not recommending one brand over the other, and I don't want to fuel into the AMD versus Intel debate. In fact, I've been quite happy with this upgraded rig over my previous one, and I've enjoyed huge performance gains in pretty much every phase of my workflow. Secondly, I'm not in any way asserting that my results are the final word on this topic, and as with most things, your mileage may vary. I do, however, have a lot of experience with Premiere Pro, with building PCs, and with this particular type of workflow. Lastly, when I say my old rig, I'm referring to an Intel i7-2600K using an NVIDIA GTX 970. It had 24 gigs of RAM, and it was overclocked to 4.7 gigahertz, and it was running on quality SSDs. It was a decent performer, but as my 4K edits started to get more complex, I was losing a lot of time with dropped frames, with scrubbing delays, and with the application of effects. The new rig is an Intel i7-8700K overclocked to 4.9 GHz. It has an NVIDIA GTX 1080 in it. It has super fast NVMe drives and 32 gigabytes of RAM. My 4K timeline is significantly smoother on the new rig, and my workflow has been significantly sped up. I'm happy, the build went well, no issues, and I grabbed some nice sales, all is well. Now I want to show you some numbers with the exports of the before and after the old rig and the new rig using Premiere. Oh, and for those of you that are curious, I always have the latest version of Premiere, and right now that is 12.1.2 build 69. As of this recording. All right, so I did an export before and after the upgrade using the same project. This was a typical project for me intended for a YouTube video. We've got 4K footage at 24p. It was an MP4 container using H.264. It's usually between 8 and 12 minutes, but this particular one was just over 11 minutes. It had audio effects, a color grade, transitions, and a bunch of picture-in-picture stuff, which would have 1080p screen captures, sort of like, you know, mixed in with the footage. There was on-screen animations like I do often, and some segments with multiple 4K video in multiple layers that would have masks in order to sort of integrate the footage together. There was also lots of motion and position keyframes, but I wasn't using any warp stabilizers or anything like that. On my old rig, this type of timeline would only be tolerable at points until it would reach the heavier areas, which would just become pretty much unusable unless I rendered it out first. But on the new rig, it's pretty good all the way through with very few drop frames. Now, when it comes to exporting for YouTube, the settings that I typically use are 4K, 24p, and an MP4 with H.264. I render at maximum depth and maximum quality. Those are both checked. I use high profile, the level is 5.1, and I use two-pass variable bitrate with the target set to 24 megabits per second and the maximum set to 96 megabits per second. Also, I export using Premiere Pro and not Media Encoder. When I did these tests with Media Encoder, they were typically about 5 to 6% longer versus using the internal exporter inside of Premiere Pro. When using these settings to export on the old rig, it took me 41.3 minutes to complete, and this is averaged out after exporting 3 times. Now on the new rig though, it took me 23.1 minutes, again, averaged out over 3 runs. So that was a pretty nice jump for me, nearly cutting my export time in half. And I wanted to give you all this information about my before and after in case you are considering a similar upgrade to me, and maybe the Intel hardware encoding thing was a factor, which we're just about to get into. But I wanted to tell you that excluding that Intel hardware encoding thing as a factor, I am still quite happy with this upgrade because of these gains that I described earlier, and I definitely think it was worth it even though I don't use the Intel hardware encoding. Now let's get into that Intel stuff. So after I did those tests and I had my baseline, I was eager to see how much more I could even improve my results now that I had that Intel hardware encoding option in the dropdown that I didn't have before in the old rig. So I went into Premiere Pro in the export window and I dropped down hardware encode, and right away I was greeted with my first disappointment that nobody mentioned in any of the videos that I watched leading up to building the computer, which is that the two-pass option is just not available. And there's quite a few posts in the forums of people saying, why can't I choose hardware? Why can't I choose hardware? And it's because if the encoder isn't set up exactly within the confines of what is allowed for the hardware encoding, you just can't use it. It'll say, that's not compatible. And so one of those limitations is that you can't use two-pass you can only use one pass. And that was disappointing because I use two pass all the time. And this is gonna be kind of a common theme going forward about the videos that I watched leading up to it, not mention it, because when this feature was announced a few months ago, my feed was slammed with all these videos that were like, amazing new feature, you know, switching back to Intel, extreme speeds, yada yada, and they were comparing with benchmarks and with bar graphs how like a medium to high tier processor can match some of the extreme enthusiast X series processors out there with export times by enabling this Intel hardware encoding. And that's troublesome to me because obviously those extreme processors, they don't have the iGPU features that allowed them to enable to use the hardware encoding, so they have to do it the old-fashioned way. But don't be fooled, these processors are not the same thing. But we're gonna get into that in just a few seconds. Anyway, so as I was saying, nobody really mentioned that it was only one pass, and of course one pass is much faster than two pass, so when I did that test, the results for the hardware encoding was significantly faster than my 23.1 minute tests from before. I did it in 12.1 minutes using the new hardware accelerated Intel thing, again, over a 3-run average. So that's nearly twice as fast as my previous export, which of course would make for a great bar graph, but this isn't comparing apples to apples, so I had to go back again and test my software settings, but this time choose the one pass encoding. And I kept pretty much everything the same, you know, 24 megabits per second, etc. All I did was change it to VBR one pass. And when I did the export that time, the results were 12.5 minutes instead of the 12.1 on hardware, which is hardly as impressive and does not make for as interesting of a bar graph. It's only a few percent difference. Now, there's no sense complaining about that few percent if it's free. It's a free couple percent improvement. Why not, right? Except for, regardless of how many times I did it, I kept getting the same recurring problem, which is this. Crazy glitches and artifacts that would roll over the screen, and they would occur once every 5 to 6 minutes on average. Now, I ran this export well over 15 times, changing one thing at a time to see if I could eliminate what was causing these artifacts and glitches. I even used a different encoder, the H265 one, which is the other one that allows the Intel hardware accelerated encoding option, and I couldn't eliminate the problem. No matter what I did, which included changing the drivers, rolling back to old drivers, changing the configuration inside of Premiere Pro, changing my overclock settings, I was still getting these glitches about 1 to 2 times per video or about every 5 to 6 minutes. I concluded that it must just be instability within that Intel hardware encoder, but I couldn't find any resources about it on the internet. And not a single one of those videos that I mentioned earlier that were hyping this thing ever mentioned anything about artifacts or glitches, but maybe they weren't actually watching the videos back. They were just exporting them and recording the times for the sake of the benchmarks. Now, another peculiar thing that I noticed about those videos is that in order to make the comparisons and do the tests, they needed the control against the Intel hardware one. And for the control test, they were setting it to software only, but they weren't setting it to software in the export window, which is the only fair way to do it. They were setting it to software only in the project settings inside the rendering and playback option. Now, this doesn't really make any sense at all, because you're crippling your machine to not even using your dedicated GPU, and you're using only software, where if you do it in the export window, you're basically just turning the Intel hardware thing on and off. And it doesn't really make any sense how not having the Intel hardware thing should make you not be able to use your dedicated GPU. It's not like it disappears from your system if you don't use the Intel hardware acceleration. But I mean, it makes for more compelling bar graphs, because having software only without any CUDA acceleration at all obviously gets absolutely crushed by having CUDA acceleration and Intel hardware acceleration. And I think this is the reason why my tests were so much closer together than their tests, because theirs were comparing having basically two GPUs to zero, and mine was comparing having the exact same, much more useful dedicated GPU and turning the Intel thing on and off, which makes for less significant results when it comes to H264, like I said, of less than 5% difference. Now, I specified H264 because when I was testing H265 in order to see if I could get rid of those glitches and artifacts, I did notice that there was a greater disparity between having the Intel hardware thing on and off when exporting using H265, because my numbers were 18.1 minutes when using software, but when I enabled Intel hardware acceleration, it went to 12.3 minutes. So that is actually, I mean, that's a decent gain compared to 12.5 and 12.1 or whatever. I mean, that's a noticeable difference. But unfortunately, the H265 was also victim to the 1 to 2 seconds of garbled, artifact-ridden chaos every 5 to 6 minutes. And again, all of this is only relevant if you plan to do one-pass encoding. If you're a two-pass person like me, then this Intel hardware acceleration thing is a complete non-starter. So in conclusion, after all my tests, I'm gonna go back to software only with regard to the Intel GPU. I'm obviously gonna leave NVIDIA hardware acceleration CUDA on, and I'm gonna go back to VBR 2-pass because I like that best, and it's glitch-free, and it's still so much faster than my old rig was. In the end, for me, the Intel hardware acceleration option introduced a few months ago in Premiere Pro, while significantly faster in very specific targeted benchmarks, offers no real advantage to a user trying to get the highest quality exports possible. If, however, you just wanted it for the ability to make proofing versions that you can export as quickly as you can where glitches and quality don't really matter, then maybe you'll enjoy having the hardware acceleration. But for me personally, I'd rather lose that extra 5 or 3% of time to be able to send my client something glitch-free using VBR OnePass software, rather than just save a little bit of time and present those strange artifacts in my video. Also, something I forgot to mention earlier, but the file sizes were not consistently different using one export method over another, meaning basically that if you're trying to conserve file size, Intel hardware acceleration will not really offer you any benefit in that regard. And so combining all this information, this is why I made that comparison earlier to the high-end X series processors from Intel, or even the Threadrippers from AMD. Those processors are just much faster without gimmicks, much in the same way that my new rig is much faster than my old rig. It's not because of some drop-down box that was added to Premiere Pro. The hardware is just better. Now, the pricing on those extreme enthusiast chips goes way up, sure, but what annoyed me was some of the videos that were suggesting that they were going to switch back to Intel from some high-end AMD chip because of this new hardware accelerated drop-down feature, and that just makes no sense to me. If you're on an AMD system with a high-end processor and you're getting the results you want, this is not a feature to be switching platforms for. Because those high-end AMD chips, just like the X series Intel processors, are gonna pull the numbers that you want using the settings that you want, regardless if you wanna use some two-pass VBR on some strange codec, they're gonna have your back. This Intel hardware encoding feature is so limited in use and scope that it does not compare to those extreme processors in any regard except for very particular synthetic benchmarks, and it's nothing to fanboy about. And this is coming from somebody that's been happily using Intel for over 20 years and is still happy with Intel today. But like I said in the beginning, my results might be different from yours, so I'd love to hear what your experience is with this Intel hardware encoding feature in Premiere Pro. If you've used it, whether you like it or not, and how it's affected your results with regard to quality and export times. Please let me know in the comments below. But that's gonna be it for me. I hope you found this video helpful or at least entertaining. And if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, feel free to hit the dislike button twice. All right, I'm done.